Let us pray. Our God in heaven, we thank you very much for bringing us together to study and to eat this spiritual food tonight. We pray, O Lord, you'll bless all your people in Jesus' name. We pray that the intake of your word will bring your blessings into our lives. Grant us more grace that we'll be obedient to your word. And in obedience, we pray that your blessings will multiply in every one of our lives. In Jesus' name, we pray. We're still in the study of the Epistle of James. Today, we're in chapter 4. And we're looking at verses 7 to 10. Please open your Bible as we read together. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted, and mourn, and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Amen. Today we're looking at these a few verses, but you'll find these verses are filled with imperatives and commandments. And at the same time, they are filled with the promises of the Lord. As we examine the verses today, you will see that they contain words for everyone. A sinner, a backslider, a saint of God, a member of the church, a minister of the gospel, anyone and everyone. Some of the commandments you'll see are very directed to sinners, and the sinners are mentioned. Some of the commandments are mentioned and directed to the people that are not stable. They are double-minded. Others are just addressed to every one of us, to you and to me. The passage actually begins with submitting ourselves unto the Lord, and it ends with God lifting us up. I pray that the lifting up of the Lord we will all experience in Jesus' name. As you look at the commandments, you'll find, number one, submit yourselves to God. Number two, resist the devil. Number three, draw near unto God. Number four, cleanse your hands. Five, purify your hearts. Six, be afflicted and mourn and weep. Seven, let your laughter be turned to mourning. The eight, let your joy be turned to heaviness. Nine, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. And ten, that you'll find in the verse we'll be looking up at another time, verse 11, speak not evil one of another, brethren. And then, these commandments have the promises following them. That's the nature of things in the kingdom of God. As reaping will follow sowing. The blessings of God follow obedience. What are the promises we're given? Number one, it says the devil will flee from you. And if you know the depths and the height of such a promise of God, that means the devil, with all his activities, with all his agents, with everything he has caused in our lives, the Lord will give us the power, the resistance. We'll resist him, and everything that is of the devil will get away from us. Number two, it says God will draw near unto you. When the devil takes all his negative things, and then he departs from us, then God, with all his blessings, the abundance of his grace, he comes near unto us. And then it says, the Lord will lift you up. If you think about those three promises were given, the devil with all his works fleeing away from us, God with all his blessings coming near to us, and the Lord lifting us up, that summarizes everything that we want from the Lord in our spiritual lives. And I pray that these blessings will be ours in Jesus' name. There are three things we're going to consider in our study today. Number one, the call to gracious submission. The call to gracious submission. You want to underline that word, gracious. It's not a fearful submission. It's not because we're frightened, we're submitting to God. It's because of the link of love and grace between us and the Lord. Therefore, graciously, were submitting to the Lord. Number two, cleansing and godly sorrow. There is godly sorrow on the one hand, and then there is cleansing with the blood of the Lamb on the other hand. Number three, the condition for growing spiritual strength. Whatever strength, whatever power we need from the Lord, there is a condition we're given. And the conditions are simply stated in the passage we're looking at today. If you really want exaltation, if you want promotion, lifting up from the Lord, He shows us the conditions today. And as we do what He wants us to do, He will lift us up. Let's come back to number one, the call to gracious submission. We're in James chapter 4, verse 7. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You will find there is connection in the word of God. That's why you cannot leave one part and then jump to the other part. In verse 7, it says, therefore. What does that mean? It means because of verse 6. What is verse 6? He giveth more grace. And the latter part of verse 6, it says, He giveth grace to the humble. Because He gives grace to the humble, because of that fact that His grace, His abundance, His blessing is awaiting the people that are humble, therefore, submit yourselves unto God. But then submission to God is one side of the deal. The other side of the deal is resist the devil. And then it says he will flee from you. Let us look at those two sides of the coin. The first part is that we submit ourselves unto the Lord in 2 Chronicles chapter 33. 2 Chronicles chapter 33 verses 12 and 13. Here we are told, and when he was in affliction, he besought the Lord his God, and he humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers, and he prayed unto him, and he was entreated of him, and heard his supplication, and he brought him again unto Jerusalem into his kingdom. Then Manasseh knew that the Lord, he was God. If you knew the atrocious, terrible things Manasseh had done, if God were man, Manasseh would never have been forgiven. He had gone into the depth of sin. He had killed the innocent. He had shed innocent blood. But when he humbled himself in the sight of the Lord, then the Lord forgave him for even forgot all that he had done and showed grace unto him. That's why he's telling us wherever we are now, if you happen to be a sinner, you are far away from God, you can come to the Lord as Manasseh came to the Lord. Once you humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, you submit yourself under the mighty hand of God, He will forgive. The blessings of God will come to you. Are you a backslider? And you've gone far away from the Lord like the prodigal son. You've wasted all the resources of the Father upon you. You can come. He drew near to God. And as he drew near to God, I'm talking about the prodigal son. That prodigal son submitted himself to the Lord. And then the Lord had mercy upon him. How about a child of God? You too, you can come to the Lord and submit yourself to the Lord. And the Lord will definitely have mercy. Jeremiah chapter 13. Jeremiah chapter 13, reading there in verse 18. Jeremiah chapter 13, verse 18. Hear the word of the Lord, still is emphasizing the same thing. It says, say unto the king and to the queen, humble yourselves, sit down, and for your transgression, for your principalities shall come down, even the crown of your glory. Here is telling the king and the queen, is telling it's not only the poor people, it's not only the illiterates, it's not only the people that are not well to do, even the king, even the queen, no matter who we are, we're to submit ourselves unto the Lord. Come back to James. In James chapter 4, reading in that verse 7, submit yourselves therefore unto God. That's the secret of blessing in the sight of the Lord. Remember the words of James. He says, be not hearers of the word only, be doers of the word. But I told you, there are two sides to the coin. On the one hand, submit to God. on the other hand, resist the devil and then he will flee from you. Those two things are very important, because when you say yes to God, automatically you must say no to the devil. When you draw near to God, automatically you get far away from the devil. When you have the light of the Lord in your life, automatically you reject the darkness of the devil away from your life. On the one hand then, submit yourself unto God. But then on the other hand, resist the devil. How do you resist the devil? Let's come to Peter, 1 Peter chapter 5, reading verses 8 and 9. 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a roaring lion, seeketh, he walketh about, seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. It tells us something here. It tells us that we should resist the devil. How do we resist the devil? Resist the devil steadfastly. That is, with all your strength, with all determination, that you say no to the devil. It may bring enticement. It may bring allurement. It may bring temptation. It may even be threat. It may give you false promises. I'll give you this, I'll give you that. Resist the devil. Refuse his offer. Reject everything he wants to give you. You do that steadfastly in the faith. And you do that with the word of God, the written word of God. Just like Jesus said, it is written. And then eventually the devil had no choice. He had to leave him. The same thing you are to do when he brings that temptation to you. Remember, if you accept the temptation of the devil, he wants to put you into a snare. But then you fight against it. You give no place at all to the devil in Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 27. Neither give place to the devil. It's a very dangerous thing. If you give the devil an inch, he will go more than a mile. Just give him a little chance, and then he will get into your life and ruin every good thing that's there in your life. That's why you will not give the devil any chance in your life. You're fighting the good fight of faith. Fight against him. Resist the devil. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 12 and 13. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. You see the calling that we're given, we're to graciously submit unto the Lord. And then we are to steadfastly resist the devil with the word of God, with prayer, the prayer of faith, and then faith in the blood of the Lamb, rejecting everything and anything that he may offer. And if we do that, we will overcome in Jesus' name. What's the promise he has given us? Look at James now again. James chapter 4, reading there in verse 7 again. James chapter 4. Verse 7, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Isn't it a wonderful thing that that promise is made to everyone? Whether you are a young convert or you are an adult, matured believer, if you will resist the devil the way Jesus Christ did it, you do it in faith, you do it with the word, you do it under the banner and the cover of the blood of the Lamb, he will flee from you, you will be victorious. We go to point number two, cleansing and godly sorrow. Cleansing and godly sorrow. We look at verses 8 and 9 of the passage we're studying. It says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners. Purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted, and mourn, and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, and let your joy be turned to heaviness. Here we find imperatives, that means commandments of the Lord. And if we obey these commandments, then we'll find the riches of the kingdom of God in our lives. Let's take them one by one. Number one, it says, draw near unto God. Then it says, he will draw near unto you. There are some people that complain somehow in their prayer, God, why are you so far away? Or they'll be talking to other people. They'll say, I don't understand why. I used to be very near to God when I was born again. When I first knew the Lord, the intimacy, the fellowship, the communion, the partnership, the sharing, it was too much. In fact, the Spirit of God was so much upon me. And then he will tell me this before it happens. He will show me that before it happens. But now, God is so far away. There's a solution the Lord is giving you tonight. You know what you did at that time? You know, you drew near to God at that time. In that same way today, as you feel that God is far away and you do not have his fellowship and his love and his grace and the sense of his intimacy like you used to have, it says the solution is you draw near to God and he will draw near unto you. The promise is made to everyone. That's why Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Are you a sinner? And you realize you are very far away, and you know there is a barrier between you and God. Draw near to God. How do you do that? You repent. You turn away from sin. You embrace Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. That's drawing near to God. He will draw near to you with his salvation. He will forgive your sins, and then you'll have fellowship with him. Are you a prodigal son, a prodigal daughter? You've wandered far away, and now you spent everything you had in riotous living. And you know that you are not where you used to be. The fellowship you used to have. The prayer life you used to have. And the Shekinah glory of God in your life that was there before is no more there now. What do? Like that prodigal son, there was a realization. He realized. He said, he came unto himself. There was a resolution. He said, I will arise and go unto my father. There was a return. He actually rose up and he came to the father. And then there was a rejoicing. The father saw him afar off. Draw near to God. He will draw near to you. He ran after him and they met and embraced one another. If you are a backslider, the Lord is waiting for you. Don't think he will not forgive. You know the way you went away from the Lord. Trace your steps back and you will have him. Are you born again? You are a child of God. The commandment is also to you and to me as we are born again. Draw near to God. Are you satisfied with the grace of God you have? Are you satisfied with the blessings of God you have? Don't you want more from the Lord? Are you not saying, I want God to be near as God was unto Moses, as near as God was unto David, as near as God was unto Peter, unto John, the disciple whom Jesus loved? You say, yes, that's what I want. Well, the secret is then, draw near unto God, and he will draw near unto you. It's both sides. If you are waiting and saying, well, if God wants to draw near unto me, if he wants me to draw near unto him, let him do it first, then I will follow. No, you are to take the initiative, and you are to show that you want the Lord. You want more of the Lord. Draw near to God, he will draw near to you. 2 Chronicles chapter 15. In 2 Chronicles chapter 15, verse 2, it says, and he went out to meet Asa, and said unto him, hear ye me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin, the Lord is with you while you are with him. You see that? If you seek him, he'll be found of you. But if you forsake him, he will forsake you. You will not forsake the Lord. I said you will not forsake the Lord. The Lord is so good and the Lord is so sweet. We want more of him. We're not going to draw away from him. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22. Let us draw near. How do we draw near? With a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, our bodies being washed with pure water. And let us hold fast unto the profession of our faith without wavering, because he is faithful that promise. We're back in James chapter 4. James chapter 4, reading there in verse 8. The second part, cleanse your hands, ye sinners. Here he tells us that whenever we sin, you know what he's talking about here is that we have hands, we have head, we have heart. The head imagines it, or the mind. The heart loves the thing Then it's the hand, that is the action, that acts it out. It's talking about the activities of sin. And those sins, in activities in our lives, they defile us. And because we're defiled, if we have sinned, if we are backsliding, that's why it says, cleanse your hands. What he means is, all the activities, all the things you have done that brought defilement, let there be a cleansing. Isaiah chapter 1, let me read from verse 15. When ye spread your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Yea, when ye make many prayers, I will not hear. Why, Lord? Your hands are full of blood. Because they shed innocent blood, maybe abortion, maybe they killed other people or whatever they did, then it says, now wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do well, seek judgment, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, and plead for the widows. What's the consequence? Come now, and let us reason together, says the Lord. Do you see what a wonderful God we have, a loving God that we have? He's talking to the sinners. He said, you cleanse your hand, ye sinners. What if we have gone too far? What if we have done abominable things? He said, come now, let us reason together. If you are willing to turn away from your sin and repent, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. I pray we will all be willing. And we will eat the good of the land in Jesus' name. In James, we're back in James chapter 4. We're looking at what follows there. He now says, purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Double-minded. Who are the double-minded people? Those are the unstable people. Those are the people that do not have a firm decision, a firm commitment to follow the Lord. Look at 1 Kings chapter 18. 1 Kings chapter 18. And let us see what it means to be double-minded. It says in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 21, and Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long halt ye between two opinions? One leg here, the other leg there. I will serve the Lord today. The next moment he has changed. He's not making up his mind. Halting between two opinions. He wants to get to the light, but the darkness is pulling him. He wants to serve the Lord, but the things of the world, he will not leave alone. The Lord says he's not happy with such a condition. Make up your mind. The Lord is so sweet and is good and great to serve the Lord. Make up your mind then. Purify your hearts, ye double-minded. What does it mean to purify our hearts? Let's look at 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7, here is the word of the Lord for everyone. It says, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved. What are the promises? He tells us in verses 17 and 18 of the previous chapter. That's what he's referring to. Come, wherefore, come out from among them. Be ye separate, says the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. That's the promise. I will be a father unto you. That's the promise. And ye shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord. That's the promise, the Lord Almighty. He now tells us in chapter 7, verse 1, having therefore these promises we have read about in chapter 6, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of the Lord. If you will come and you'll wash once again in the blood of the Lamb, the blood of Jesus Christ that is shed for you and for me, the Lord will not push us away. He will cleanse us. He will wash us. He will forgive and forget all our iniquities. You'll become like a newborn baby because everything will be totally new. Come back to James chapter 4. We're looking at verse 9. Be afflicted, mourn, weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Who is this talking about? Is this talking to a sinner? Oh yes. A sinner that now knows his wretchedness and his spiritual blindness and his spiritual poverty, and he sees a lot that he has missed from the kingdom of God, and he sees that as he had been away from the kingdom of God, he had actually ruined himself. It says, now be afflicted and mourn and weep. Cry the cry of repentance and weep with sorrow, godly sorrow in your heart, and come to the Lord. It says, be afflicted and mourn and weep. What's that talking about? Is that addressed to the backslider? Oh yes, it's addressed to the backslider. As the backslider had been away from the kingdom of God, his colleagues, his fellow brothers and sisters who remained in the kingdom of God, they had been serving the Lord. The Lord is preparing a mansion for them. The Lord is preparing a crown for them. They already have stars in their crown. He now realizes how empty, how shallow, how dry he is. As he realizes, if he had not left the kingdom of God, what glorious things will be waiting for him? What is he to do? Is to weep, is to mourn, is to be afflicted. Is that talking to believers at all? You better believe it's talking to believers. You are a believer. You see your junior brother, your junior sister, see your relatives all going to hell, rushing into hell. And they have nothing to do with Jesus Christ. And the Spirit of God is telling you, look at your family. You have seen the light, and these people have not come to the light. Are they going to perish like that? I'm sure you are weeping and mourning. You are afflicted. Not only that, if you are a parent, you are born again, you are serving the Lord, and your child is a shame to you, it's a shame to the church, it's a shame to the kingdom of God, and people are pointing at you and saying, the father is a good man, the mother is a good woman, but look at these children. How is it that the children of preachers are always like this? I'm sure when you see that, you are afflicted, you are mourning, and you are weeping. If you are not married, you love the Lord, you honor the Lord, on the street, in the bus, you see them joking with the name of Christ, and you see them kind of be dishonoring the Lord, and you see them doing things that are not right. It brings sorrow in your heart. That's what he's saying. He's telling everyone, we as children of God, we cannot be going about with frivolity and laughing everywhere. You see, there'll be sobriety in us, there'll be mourning in us. In fact, that's what Jesus said. Look at it, Matthew chapter 5. In Matthew chapter 5, reading there in verse 4, it says, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Are you a sinner and you are mourning because of your sin? He will give you salvation, you'll be comforted. Are you born again, but you are not sanctified, and you see that thing coming up in your heart, that irritation every time, and it appears that you are not living in that deep peace of the Lord that passes understanding? You are sorrowful. You are unhappy. You say, Lord, I'm saved, but what a miserable life is this. I'm not enjoying that salvation. When you mourn like that, he will comfort you and sanctify you. You are saved. You are sanctified, but you are not baptized in the Holy Ghost. You are powerless, you are shallow, and when you even read the word of God, you don't know the deep meaning of the word of God, everything looks superficial to you. Say, Lord, I've been a Christian now for 10 years, for 15 years. Look at the condition in which I am. I'm not happy with my spiritual growth. I'm not happy with myself. Blessed are they that mourn, and they shall be comforted. He'll bring power into your life. But you have been a soul winner, you have been a house fellowship leader. Instead of the house fellowship growing, it is scattering. The people are not coming again. The people that came and they said they were born again from the retreat, we put them in your house fellowship, they backslid right before your face right there. And then you say, Lord, what is all this? Instead of the things being improved, it is going down. You are mourning. You are not happy because you are spiritually barren. It says, blessed are those that mourn, for they shall be comforted. I pray God will comfort you. And then it says, let your laughter be turned to mourning, and let your joy be turned to heaviness. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 10 and 11. Here he tells us, for godly sorrow worketh repentance, not to be repented of, that we do not regret. But the sorrow of the world worketh death. But for behold, the selfsame thing, that ye sorrowed after a godly sort,
What carefulness it wrought in you. Yea, what clearing of yourself. Yea, what indignation. Yea, what fear. Yea, what vehement desire. Yea, what zeal. Yea, what revenge. In all things you have approved yourself to be clear in this matter. That means when you are sorrowful, when you mourn, when you are not happy with the way things are, and you say, Lord, there must be an improvement. I cannot continue like this. You must enrich my life. You must refresh my life. Things must change. The Lord will come. There will be a mighty change in Jesus' name. We go to point number three now, the condition for growing spiritual strength. The condition for growing spiritual strength. If you're a real child of God, no matter what you have got, no matter your state, you want to grow more, you want to get more, you want to be enriched more in the kingdom of God. You want to be a real firebrand in the hand of the Lord. You want to do exploits for the Lord. What's the condition? It's in verse 10. James chapter 4 verse 10. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. You remember Joseph? He was in the dungeon. He was in the prison. The Lord lifted him up. You remember Moses? He had run away to the Midianites. The Lord raised him up. He became a leader over the people. You remember Joshua? The Lord raised him up and said, rise up and lead these people to the land of Canaan. Do you remember David? When he ran away, but he humbled himself. He told the people, he said, well, if that is what the Lord wanted for me, that's all right. I will not fight against his will. He humbled himself and the Lord raised him up and brought him back again. Do you remember Nebuchadnezzar? When he was proud, he said, this is the great Babylon that I built by the power of my majesty. And then the voice came, you are the one that you were told that the kingdom will depart from you. And then all of a sudden, his brain was turned. He now became like an animal. But then when he humbled himself, the Lord raised him up after seven seasons had passed and brought him back to the throne again. Do you remember Jesus Christ? He humbled himself to the death of the cross. And then the Lord raised him up. Now the Lord had exalted him. You know what we are praying? And you know what we are singing? We're singing and praying. Give us another Elijah today. Now, you know, I've been wondering that since we have been singing that song and since we have been praying that prayer, where is that Elijah? We want another Paul. We want another Samuel. We want another David that will kick Goliath. We want another spiritual giant that will be able to go to the battle of the Lord and do exploits for the Lord. You are the Elijah we are waiting for. You are the Esther we are waiting for. You know the problem? You have not humbled yourself before the Lord. You have just been walking about. Of course you read the Bible. Of course you pray. But you have not submitted yourself the way the Lord wants you to be submissive unto him. If you will do it today and say, yes, Lord, I come to you. Yes, Lord, I want that power to come upon my life. I want to do something in this life that will count for eternity. I've played enough. I've been jovial enough. I've been going about laughing and all that enough. Frivolity, now it has come to an end. Just being shallow, it has come to an end. I want the Lord to lift me up. And good enough, the year is still, you know, in front of us. We have just spent just a quarter of the year. And quite a lot is in front of us. Do you know for the rest of the year, if you will make up your mind today, the way God did it for Isaiah, the way God did it for Paul the Apostle, and the way God did it for Peter, and did it for all those people, Lord, I'm a candidate. I want to be lifted up. I want to be exalted. I want your power in my life. I don't want to be as weak as I am now. I want my preaching to take effect. I want you to surround me with your Holy Spirit and fire. I want something today that I never got since I was born again. Do you know the Lord can do it today? I said, do you know the Lord can do it today? And you know, we need to spend time with the Lord in prayer. If you will come, even now, if you will rise up now and say, yes, Lord, I am here. I want something. The song we are singing, the prayer we are praying, give us another Elijah. Give us another Esther. Give us another Deborah. Give us another Mary. Give us another Paul. I am available. I am here. I want to do it. Oh Lord, I want to serve you. And I want your power to fill my life. He will do it. He will do it. The condition is that you'll be humble. The condition is that you will submit yourself under the mighty hand of the Lord. If you do your part, he will do his part.
If you do your part, he will do his part. Frivolity will come to an end. Carelessness will come to an end. Prayerlessness will come to an end. Just roaming about, useless visitation will come to an end. Unseriousness will come to an end. Not understanding why you are in the kingdom at such a time like this, that will come to an end. Make me another Elijah. Make me another Elisha. Make me another David that will kill and slay Goliath. Make me another Paul. Make me another Peter. Make me another Esther. Make me another Deborah. Let me do something for you in this my single life. The Lord will answer your prayer. If you are not born again, call upon the Lord and be born again. If you are not sanctified, call upon the Lord and be sanctified. If you are not baptized in the Holy Ghost, call upon the Lord and be baptized in the Holy Ghost. The Lord is waiting for you. Draw near to God and he will draw near unto you.